pretty cool, isn't it?
It's just like a little bit of like a comic gap, you know? Because, you know, I am from Weaver and like.
You can stay in state.
Like, you know, big mounts.
Just like a
but it is like a small sound people were like apples that like my back is not the first one.
What you're saying? Material existence, whether it's in the form of energy or not, your energy matter conversion with this instant equation, E equals MC squared, right? How energy can be converted to matter and vice versa. That's reality, reality in existence. If these things exist, whether energy or matter, or any of this form, you cannot simply assume at one point there was absolutely nothing because of it. Because the universe is postulated to come into existence with an effect. So there has to be a cause for this. And we are saying either the causes are cause or causes of this universe is one cause. Prior to this, no cause, but that cause has to be independent, self-sufficient. If it's not, then it doesn't answer the question. Because if a cause exists for this universe, what caused that cause? Yeah. We can ask this question and go on and on and forever. If it goes on forever, or it can go in a cycle. So we started by analyzing the cyclical cause. And you already said it doesn't make sense if it's a cyclical cause. It's like saying you will do something if this gentleman does it first. You're dependent on him for you to do an action. And he's dependent on him and goes back all the way that I'm dependent on you and you. Then the action will never proceed. Let me give you an example. Okay, here's the bag, right? You want to lift this bag up from the ground. You're going to start first, right, at the point of this exercise. But you will only lift it up if this gentleman lifts it first. And this gentleman will lift this bag if he lifts before him. And likewise, if this gentleman lifts before him, then he will lift it. He says, if I lift it before him, then he will lift it. And goes like this. Okay, would you finish it? Would this bag ever be lifted? No. Of course not. Because all depend on each other before this action proceeds. It will never happen. So cyclical cause of the universe is not a rational answer to explain the cause of our universe. What about a cause or causes of our universe that doesn't end? Does that answer rational? So there are always causes for our universe. There are always causes in the past. So we don't have to worry about that. There's some cause in the distant past which has no beginning, which carries on ad infinitum. Even that is absurd. You don't agree? To illustrate that, I mean, if you're wondering why this is, same again. This is my bag. It needs to go to your hand, right? It's an action. But before I give this bag to you, there are infinite number of people in front of me which has to now pass this bag around before it goes. So from me to you, there are infinite number of people the bag has to pass through. Would this bag ever come to you if there are infinite number of them? No, it will never. Because the moment you come to you, there's someone else in front of you. So what it shows that if this universe is in exists, and or came into existence, more precisely, as scientists are telling us, there cannot be, because the bag is actually already in your hand. It came to your hand. But that means the causes were not infinite. If the causes were infinite, if there were infinite number of people, the bag would not go into your hand. The fact that the bag went from me to you, that means the causes were finite. That's the only way it can work. So if the universe is created or in existence, came into existence, the causes cannot be infinite. That means the cause of our universe has a definable point where we can say it's not infinitely onwards, going backwards. But the cause from which we can't go any further, the cause has to be absolute. This cause cannot be caused by something else. It has to be uncaused. That's the only way you can arrive at a conclusion saying this is how it will work. The universe exists, and the only way we can rationally understand that is when a cause is uncaused. That's what we say about God. God is independent, not caused by anything. Self-sufficient. Independent, self-sufficient. So when we as believers, I'm a Muslim, right? When we explain to people about Islam, it is the rational understanding of reality. It is not irrational, something that people made up somewhere, because science is making an irrational statement here by making up multiverses to go away with this problem. But you know that the explanation about this for you from Islam, that there has to be a creator of this universe who is self-sufficient and independent. It makes sense. We can accept that. It makes sense here. It makes sense to your heart. How many of those independent self-sufficient creators of this universe? Think about it. Can there be more than one? As Muslims, we say Islam teaches us that there is only one absolute entity or a being or a creator, to be precise, who created this universe. One absolute creator. The Quran says, had there been more than one absolute, had there been more than one God, there would be corruption and chaos. So I illustrate again with another example to solidify what we mean. Imagine there are cars which have independent steering wheels.
Yeah? I think so, yeah.
Both of you got on a car. Independent steering wheels. So you can actually drive the way you want it. You will go wherever you want to take it. He can do the same thing. You are independent and self-sufficient. You don't have to listen to someone else or compromise on someone else. Your will. This car up north, yeah, to Manchester. And this gentleman, he says, I am going to drive the car to the south, to Brighton, nearabouts, right? Going south. Where's the car going to go? Two independent drivers making the car to independently go. Is he going to go in both places? Of course not. We're still seeing the chaos now already, because you are independent and you are able to, because the creator is also all powerful, by bringing this universe into existence, you can appreciate the amount of power as creator possesses, the amount of energy that is required in this universe. You know, just from, you know, how if you split one atom, how much energy you can get from there, let alone the whole energy of this universe. Some people try to say zero just to counteract that. Huge amount of energy in this universe. So the creator is powerful enough to carry out the will. So if you are two creators and you wanted to create something independently, you want to create or do something, you want to say, I want to make now rain, and you say, no, I want to be without any rain, what's going to happen? You are all powerful enough to do whatever you wish to do. Either there is rain or there isn't rain. If, say, you wanted rain to happen right now, pouring rain, cats and dogs, that's an expression, right? Heavy rain, and the lady here, she says, I want no rain at all, full sunshine. Now, if there is full sunshine happening, and still happens for the next, you know, whole of this day, remaining day, then you failed miserably to carry out this action that you intended to do while you were all powerful. So that would render you not all powerful, not absolute, because you failed to do whatever you wanted to do. Because you wanted rain, but there was sunshine. And vice versa. If rain happened, the lady wasn't all powerful. Yeah? So if the car, coming back to the car, goes only to the north, which you wanted, for example, I forgot who wanted to go to the north, say you wanted to go take it to the north, then you are in control. You are powerful. But the lady, unfortunately, was unable, not all powerful enough to take the car to the north. This illustrates to you that you cannot have more than one absolute being in control in reality. It simply doesn't work. There will be corruption, chaos, and ruin. If none of it happened, it went neither to the north or to the south, none of you are all powerful. So the creator who is all powerful can only be one creator. that demonstrates to you the idea that people have about polytheistic understanding of God. There are many gods. Yeah? Many gods is an irrational concept. Because you can't have many gods in reality. Just like you can't have two absolute beings, you can't have many absolute beings. So when the Quran, have you heard of this book? The Quran. The Quran. The Quran is a book that we believe is a divine speech of our Creator for our guidance, which explains to us who God is, who we are, where we come from, what we're doing here, and what we're supposed to do, and where we're going. It gives us the guidance. And this Quran explains about the reality of God and the reality of this universe. It tells us this God that He is, say, Qul, He is Allah, Hu Allahu Ahad. Qul Hu Allahu Ahad. Say He is Allah, the one, the only, the unique. Allahu Samad. The one who is independent, the one who is absolute, the one who is free from all wants and needs. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. Quran is in Arabic, right? So I'm using the Arabic expressions. That He is not born, neither does He produce any offspring. Meaning, He doesn't have any fathers or any children, no lineage. This way or that way, from parents or children wise. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. And there is nothing whatsoever co-equal or in comparison with Him. Nothing like Him in comparison or in co-equality. Absolutely unique. Would you not say that description of our Creator is something that your heart and your mind will find ease with?
Take a picture, my
one absolute Creator who is totally independent and self-sufficient and totally unique. Because if He wasn't unique, there would be someone like Him. He won't be where He is, right?
No, I'm cool, bro.
So,
yeah, it's fine.
This is actually a small chapter in the Quran called Surah Al-Ikhlas, Surah of Purity, Surah 112, 112 describes God in a nutshell. And the Quran throughout also describes that God is, that He is God, besides Him there is none other. You know what the word God means? The word God. When the Quran, or we use the word God, is the one who is worthy of worship. People have the sense and appreciation of reverence and gratitude to something they appreciate. That's why some people, some people, they revere and appreciate and so grateful and so much in love and respect with pop stars and football stars, right? You see how when it, pop stars, they get crazy. They're like in total submission to them, whatever they say, they want to imitate them. Many people want to imitate,
David Beckham.
Elvis Presley.
Oh, yeah.
Right? They want to look like Elvis Presley. They want to eat like Elvis Presley. They want to talk like Elvis Presley. They want to emulate him. They want to just reference this headquarters. So this feeling is something natural that we have. To show this reverence and respect and love and choose your gratitude. But Allah, God, Allah is the name that we use for God as He describes Himself. It doesn't have any Allah-es like a goddess. It cannot be made. That's my personal name of God. You can call on God. Rather than saying God, but you actually call Him with His name. And there's many other names. Perfect names. So when we call upon Allah, I've just lost the track. This Creator, and I'm gonna just when I can remember this point, I will come back to it. Allah says there is no God worthy of worship besides Him. So Allah is a being that is worthy of worship. So this word ilah is any object that is worthy of worship. But Allah is the only being that is worthy of worship. That is our declaration. When someone wants to come to this reality, the reality we're talking about, they have to come to this process of rejecting all notions of false deities and false gods. You have to abandon and shun and reject that anything is worthy of worship. Nothing. No human beings, no football stars, no David Beckhams or Elvis Presleys are worthy of worship. None are worthy of worship. No trees or monkeys or elephants or stars or planets, thunder or anything that is great in people's eyes are worthy of worship. Nothing of the creation is worthy of worship. So this is a rejection of things that cannot be and is not worthy of worship. And then you make an affirmation. There is one creator that we talked about, has to exist, self-sufficient, independent, absolute being. That creator, that God, is worthy of worship. So when someone becomes a Muslim, it's not a difficult process, it's simply negation of false deities, to say they're not worthy of worship, and affirming that only God or Allah, because that's the most appropriate word you can use to describe God, because God has goddesses, Godfather, Godmother, and so on. Allah, creator, He alone is worthy of worship. And if you worship the creator in the way the Prophet and Messenger showed you, then you come to the faith and brotherhood or sisterhood in this reality. So Islam is this state of submission, of one's will. Why do I say submission and surrender? Because we've come to exhausting all possibilities, all avenues, that it is not evolution that caused the origin of matter. It is not nothing that originated matter, or this cosmos, or this reality. So we have to somehow submit and surrender, but there is a cause, there is a reality. So this is the submission and surrender. We are saying that's it, I now acknowledge, and that's it, it has to be. So this submission, state of submission and surrender, not by force, by willingness, and with all humility, because you are acknowledging the truth. That state is called Islam. The one who does that is called a Muslim. So if you're thinking about coming to this reality, that is the process that one needs. So I would like to encourage you to join in this community of believers in this Creator by coming to this submission and surrender to the one true God, Allah, and worshipping Him in the last and final of His spokesperson, His messenger, Muhammad, peace be upon him. Because he's got the first, he was the last of them. Then you will see what the true message that we need to follow, why we are here, what's the purpose of our creation, what's going to happen to us when we die, is that the end of it or not, is there judgment day where justice will be implemented, where the wicked and the bad would not get away, and the pious and the righteous will be rewarded, there will be. So we believe, as you will realize after your submission in this state of being, that the reality is there is a day of judgment. And there will be people, unfortunately, who will go to a place of suffering because of their own choice. Choice which comes mostly from arrogance and stubbornness. And there are people, so you should be one of them, should be one of them, who willingly use their intellect, faculty of reason and rationality, to come to the conclusion that there is a creator. I hope you are on this journey, my friend. I hope you take that journey. I'm only introducing you to Islam. I'm not going to tell you to become a Muslim now. You make your own choice. You sit down at home, watch, relax, and think and ponder and reflect. Open up the Quran and see, is this what the Creator tells me? Is this from the Creator or not? And you make your journey. Once you're convinced, if you have questions, you can always ask. Come back to us. Ask your Muslim friends, wherever they are. We can clarify as best as we can. And then if you're convinced, here and here, with your intellect and with your heart, then take that path. The path which will make you successful in this life and make you successful in the hereafter. Because the true success is the success in the hereafter, the everlasting life. This life is a moment. Would you we spare the life of eternity compared to the flickering of the eye, which is this life. Eternity compared to 100 years of your life. What is it? It's nothing. Would you be in a position to really risk the life of eternity with the momentary pleasures of 100 years of this life? That wouldn't be a very intelligent thing to do. So the real life, the real success, and the real happiness would be to look out for the life which is a life of eternity. If we go to the life of eternal joy and bliss and tranquility and happiness, that's the life you should have. That's the life you should aspire for. Rather than the life where, like, I'm happy now. Life is like a cigar, smoking, and that's it. A momentary happiness. All happiness in this life momentary, they go, they come and they go. But the life in the hereafter, the continuous joy and bliss and happiness with no end. This is a reward for those who use their mind and their heart in this life and submit to their Creator without any arrogance and stubbornness. So let us be of those people who submit to the Creator with all love and humility and open heartedness, so that God showers us, the Creator showers us with His mercy in the hereafter. Do you have any copies of the Quran? I have been given by my friends who brings lots of copies. So these are free gifts, right? It's an English translation, and there's an index to it. So
take care, thanks.